For that, especially not coming as the last talk for the it was not meant this way, but well, we thought it was a nice title, and it sort of evolved. It was not quite that. It became it just before starting to present it. So what is this about? I hope this is kind of visible. It's not about Tutanchamun or whatever you pronounce this guy from Egypt. That's his coffin. It's also not about Leipzig 3. It's going to have some relation to it, and it evolved out of it in some sense. It's about an exercise in the textbook, which I will look at a little bit further, a lot of examples to it. That gets us to a different kind of coffin. And when we arrive at this point, these kind of coffins have handles, and we have some poles to carry them around.
Hello.
And when we have all this machinery around, I will take one of the examples and just redo it. And, then the last question is it exciting and why? Or is it just me that thinks it is any good? It's quite interesting that all those kind of things kind of fit together with what we had this morning and also in the afternoon. Maybe some of those thoughts also come together at the same century, if you like. Last thing, outlook. Here's the exercise directly out of the textbook source, which in this way I'm allowed to use, I think. So you see the backslashes and so on. You can read that for yourself. Why has have tech boxes only one reference point? And it's a double dangerous bend, I think, or maybe a one dangerous bend exercise, so it's not trivial to answer, and don't give the following answer. There are no good usages for having NEC symmetrical. That's one thing in the English or Latin languages. And he goes on. He had a certain kind of cap on at the time. Today he has no cap on, so we will see what he thinks about it these days. And then he says at the end, time will tell. Now, I'm not going to actually discuss that, but I will look at it a little bit about what can be done, what could be done if we had something else than a single reference point. Just to discuss the language things, people who have been to conferences in the past, tech conferences, I mean, probably all know Yannis Varoulopoulos, and he was talking quite a lot about just a single reference point to characters. Languages like Khmer and so on, they didn't work very well with this concept, but that's not what I'm going to talk about. I'm thinking more about Latin-based design stuff, and here are two examples. That's from the Latin Companion, the chapter opening, and to the right there's some basically random title of a book. I don't know how well you can see this, but the question is, if you think about this design, how would you describe those kind of things? What would be the way you would explain to somebody else what's the importance of this design, what makes it unique, what is sort of the structural thing. And let's have a look. That's the Latin Companion. First of all, we have typically baseline to baseline spacing, so something we are not really very much accustomed to if we are working with tech. But despite this, we have the main title being slightly shifted to the right here, so that's the vertical axis, and if we describe this, we would say this goes out, right? And then the next thing is, it is space here, might be fixed to the first line. So if we have a single line of chapter, the distance from here to here would stay the same compared to when we have two lines. So this distance we have to put in here depends on potentially on what the amount of text is that comes along. So that's not necessarily, if you try to describe this, a very easy thing to describe. But this is even better. You first have something like a center title. That's okay. The next thing is you have a subtitle, see it, which is flush left to the center title, right? And then as the next topic you have the publisher, Duke University, I guess you can't read this, here, down here, which is aligned here. It's all not very difficult if you think about building that in tech, right? It gets a bit more complicated if you look at what happens here. This is centered between the left line here and the left line to this text. So this goes out in both directions. Now, if this is the design, think about it, how you would implement that in something like tech. Would it resemble what I just explained? Probably not. It would probably go like we have Cartesian coordinates. There's some point here, we go up and right and left and back and forth. And if then somebody comes along and says, but I want a different font, suddenly everything goes out of order and you start remeasuring, right? Because that not would not be the way I just explained how it is built, what the essence actually is. Okay. Oh yeah, what about that? Again, baseline to baseline spacing as part of the specification is going on. Another one. Okay, not mainstream. I agree. I guess, except for Hans, not many of us do this kind of thing. But leave aside, how would you describe it? And then, if you think about it, how would you implement it? Any relation? I doubt it, to be honest. That's the way I would describe it, roughly. You have this, a line here with the poets, and the in Paris aligns with this one, and this goes up here with a bit of spacing, and then the circle thing is basically smack center here on those four blocks, and then you have this 45-degree text down here. Not roughly. So, what's the natural design description? Well, first of all, the whole time I was talking about relation of objects. I wasn't talking coordinates. This is a line at this point, maybe there's an offset, something like that. But it's a relation between the objects. And, well, I usually use some kind of natural attributes of the object. Something like the left upper corner or center or something like that. So relation to the object are those kind of things that are used for description. That is sort of typically the essence. Doesn't mean that you don't have hardwired coordinates in such a design, but it's not the main thing. That's my point here. Last example. That's from 1925. A chiseled work where the title page of a newspaper journal called Elementary Typography, and well, have a look at it. Describe the design for yourself as far as you can. You don't actually need to have the text, but look at it. Well, what are the elements and how are they related to each other? I'm not going to ask you to do it in tech. But here is sort of the graphical answer to it. There's a lot of things going on, like, for example, this block here is aligned to this text and to this text. It just gets sort of in this corner. Or this text here is then aligned to the end of this text. And coming from now, not here, the other text, and various other things. I mean, you can go into detail if you want to, and it's quite beautiful, actually. So what does it have to do with coffee? short story, history, basically, sometime last century, there was a conference I can't remember really, somewhere in the UK, and we were walking through the village there in the afternoon, there this kind of idea was born that actually what you want to have is a box with a lot of handles where you can grab things. And the mental picture back then was coffins. Now, maybe that wasn't quite a nice picture, but that was came sort of up at that point in time, and actually it got implemented, and then the implementation got more or less sort of put aside, forgotten and everything, because there was then the stuff where we started to work on template ideas and those kind of things, so it basically vanished again. And end of last year, I was starting to try and build templates for Link 3 for headings and table and floats and those kind of things. And it just didn't quite fit. I didn't find anything to describe sensibly or offer a description interface how those things and headings should relate to each other. And that was when I came back to books. There was something last century. And so that brought the copies back. We did the implementation from then, added some stuff, and now they're actually working. And for my end, I'm quite pleased with it. So that's a copy from the 19th century, that's more than one century ago. You see all the handles up here, and the poles, which are basically sticks, where you sort of go through the thing to lift it. That's the same concept. So what's this? That's tech. Reference point is much here. Don't think you can see it, but there's the reference point. That's the only handle we have. And this funny black thing is just to make sure that I do have a depth in my example. So the last line is not on the bottom, basically. Okay? So what is the coffin in contrast? It looks like this. Same text, a lot of poles, left, a right one, a top, then top of the first line, a center, a vertical center, baseline, and the bottom line. So we get a bunch of natural poles that automatically sit there, and each intersection gives you a handle, which you can use, attach to, grab. And what can we do? Well, we can build the thing. That's the first thing we had to do. We can make new ones. We can add such poles to the already existing default ones, like two-thirds of the horizontally there, we have added another pole, which is two-thirds down the line, something like this. That's that kind of operation. You can reposition them, like this one goes up, maybe you just saw it from here, it's down there, I moved it up by 10 points. You can rotate the thing, and the important part is the poles and the handles rotate with it. That's a more natural way to think about it. I mean, okay, now the top is here, but if you're working with text and stuff, and I rotate this by 90 degrees, then it's more natural to think about here's the text on the top left is here, rather than sort of thinking about it in absolute thing. My idea. Okay, it wouldn't be necessary. And last but not least, we can actually typeset the stuff. We can move it somewhere and place it. And again, we can use the handles to help with the movement. That's single coffins. Several coffins. We can align the stuff to two coffins, and that gives us these kind of things. Basically, we align at this point, which is bottom right, and for the poles, we take top left, and we say align with 2-point separation or something, or with no separation. And then we align the in pairs, top right of in pairs, with this this government, top right. Those kind of ideas. And the second thing we currently can do is we can manage the resulting bounding box. The picture here shows some gray background. That's actually the bounding box of the whole resulting picture, because those were attached without actually changing the bounding box. But that's kind of detail for what you wanted to measure. Okay, so having this kind of machinery, here is the original from 85 years ago. Let's try to do it in 10. That's the content you need to somehow manage. A bunch of rules. You may not be able to read the from the back, but anyway, this is right now very crude. It's basically a coffin, an S-box in LaTeX terms, which has some rule in it with a certain color and a certain size. I mean, this needed more. Anyway, those three rules. Then we have horizontal coffins that are like S-boxes. There's a font size, a family position, and then the word mid-tile on. So that gives us this box here. The same here with typographische, the second box, and so on and so forth. So those are here. And then I have two more, which are vertical coffins. The one here is elementary typography, and the one here is all the authors. And those are the ingredients to build it. Now we build this one. Basically, we start with aligning box A, which was the word mid-tilum, with an empty coffin. That's a technicality right now for doing this, so we can ignore that for the moment. Basically, more interesting is what does aligned coffins in general do? It basically takes two boxes, takes a handle on each box, which is optional. If you don't specify it, it takes the checkbox over the corner of the baseline. And you have some offset, which is also optional. So aligning now the word mid-tilum with the first rule on top, this one, basically we take inside the result box, we take box A, the top, this was box A, the top, and the right, so this is this corner here. And we attach the rule at bottom right, which is from the rule at this point, and we use an offset of 2 millimeters vertically. Same thing for the next two blocks. This is the box B, we rotate it by 90 degrees. Then we take it, we use this time the handle box A bottom, with box A left, which is here, this way, and box B, which is the word typography, bottom right, 2 points, and that gets us here, this thing. And then the last one is going the same way. We rotate the rule by 90 degrees and attaches basically at this point. Mechanism is fairly easy then, going on like this. This is attaching this part. We rotate by 270. We go from basically this point up here to this point. That's why we have 14 pickers vertically and 66 points to the right. This one is interesting because of the problem that we actually have to use the pole from here with the pole from this side. So what you see here is we take from the resulting box that we have, which is currently this bit here, this is already built. We take bottom left of box B. Box B was the word type of typographische. So this is this pole. Box B left, sorry, this is this pole. And box C, we take the bottom, which is this pole here, and the corner, the handle will then be at this point. And at this, with this point, we attach this coffin at the top right. So this top right of this coffin is attached at this point, and then we get exactly that what we want to have. This is just showing the handle. It's just adding this nice little block here, the copying handle. The last things to do is adding this black rule, which is working in the same fashion, and then again with two different calls, adding this block coming up here, and finally adding the word on the head, and we're done. So, not too difficult actually to get this design right. This is now not intent, what you see on the right. It is a bit different because I didn't try to get it completely right, but yeah, looks close, right? So why is it
compare to do?
Sorry?
Can we compare the two? Can we compare the two?
Yeah, compare the two. Not directly side by side, I can move back. This is the tech version. This is one suppose. Here's the original. The only problem is now I better go out of this one, right? Oops. Then What I want to do is to actually apply that in real life on the template idea so that you can do this. And that brings me to the end. Questions? Comments?
Sounds like constraint-based programming, right? You might want an even easier way to describe the stuff would be to specify in a declarative fashion all the constraints that you want on the objects and boxes. Have you looked into that?
You're quite right. That would be potentially a way to evolve these kind of things in a better fashion. Yeah.
I'm not suggesting writing a constraint solver in tech.
No.
You will.
Is this somewhere available on CTEM or something?
It is all available except for the Chichon source, which I have only on my computer. But the whole thing is in the experimental tree of the latex 3 kernel under something called X-Packages X-Covers. And it runs. It's not paperback, even if it's done in PowerPoint, sorry. The pictures were all done in tech.
Not on
C10
yet,
but
only in...
It is, sorry, C10 probably in, I'm not quite sure when the license dates were, but it is definitely on the, through the... project website and then on the SPM.
You plan to add glues to coffin positions. Do you have any plans to add some stretchability to coffins themselves? So I can say, okay, you slightly extend this coffin so it will be exactly here or there. It would be, is it possible? And do you plan to do this? Like flexible coffins.
You mean in case the guy isn't dead after all? I don't know. It is maybe an interesting idea to look at. But one of the things that I learned when I was playing with it is keep it simple. I mean, the essence stuff is really the ability to nicely sort of align those kind of things and speak about something like this float as it's captioned somewhere at the bottom with a certain offset, or this heading is related to this ornament in some way. If you start up to do a full-fledged programming level of diagrams, you come back to the stuff that you actually do not want to solve. And then you have a lot of functionality available, or probably more than make you think very usefully. I'm speculating, but I started to make things simpler. For example, specifying poles and handles. In contrast to the talk this morning, the way things are built together is after that you have the handle of the inner coffins available to you, but just without sort of specifying the order. So I went away and put a coffin twice into another thing, then you only have the handles of the last one. That's a restriction, but the usefulness is I don't have to worry about the order I sort of attach things to. So if I add something to my overall picture, it still stays, everything stays the same. I'm going for simplicity here, and I'm not sure that making coffins sort of stretch is easily to grasp. Maybe it is.
You can stretch rules, so. Okay, thank you.
You may have answered that question by your last remarks, but I'm going to ask it again. Could you combine this idea with your coffins and your handles and poles with the idea of quantizing the space also? There be a conflict between them?
You mean grid type processing?
Yes.
Actually, yes, I think that falls kind of naturally in the whole domain that you're trying to solve here. So yes, there would be value in sort of thinking about the ability to have an underlying grid that you can easily address, which in some sense is nothing else than a big canvas with a lot of poles already that are in regular distances to each other, which you can use to sort of decide on intersections of those poles, which are then used to attach stuff to. So in some sense, the idea would naturally fit. I would probably think then about something like a specifiable grid that gives you sort of a spectral handle that you can attach stuff to.
It seems like a lot of what you're talking about is similar to stuff that Metabost already does. Is
yep.
there any thought to combine them or shift the responsibility more to Metabost and make the title page in Metabost and rest it somewhere else or something?
No. I'm quite aware about that situation, in contrast to being aware that it's also an XY thing, which I should have been probably. But anyway. As far as the Metabost stuff is concerned, I think the focus is different. And what I want to have is a single language which is currently processable by a single interpreter, if you like. Of course, you could do all those kind of things in the background and pass stuff off to Metabost to get it back and forth. But again, I think that would go beyond what you're trying to reach. And then if the concept could not quite fit together, then you're not better off. So I think it is better to keep with a single syntax, whatever that syntax is going to be, in the tech world or in an interpreter world of that kind, and just solve those kind of questions up to the point of positioning text and ornaments, maybe.
Anyone else?